Good evening. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, we come to you tonight in the celebration of life for Christopher. Lord, we just want to thank you right now for his life and what it meant to so many of us. Lord, there's so much uncertainty in the world, and things happen and we don't quite understand why they're happening. But we know, Lord, that you're always constant and that you are always there. And so, Lord, right now, I just pray that you will help those that need the peace from you, that they just look to you and cling to you, Lord, for the peace that you can give. Lord, we thank you for who you are and that you are always there for us in any situation. But Lord, once again tonight, I just want to thank you for the legacy that Chris leaves behind and the legacy that we can share tonight through the memories that we have of Christopher. Lord, we love you and we thank you for all that you are to us. We thank you for the love that you consistently offer to us. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
On April 16th, 1974, Chris came into this world a fighter. During his delivery, the umbilical cord had wrapped around his body. His first few moments on Earth, he was fighting to breathe. His little spirit pushed him through these scary first moments, and he joined our family. He brought so much joy to my parents and to me. I was 5 when he came, and everyone was worried that I'd be jealous. But I absolutely loved him from the start. Chris was always very determined, tackling new challenges, one of the first being escaping his crib when he was very little. Mom would hear a thud and he'd manage to pull himself up and over the railing. He had a sense of wonder and he loved nature. Our house always was filled with animals. There were many escaped hamsters, precious dogs, bunnies, and rescued cats in Chris's life. Chris had a way with words as he grew. He altered our family language early on when he'd mispronounce words. We all thought it was so cute that we'd adopt his version. Some of my favorites were bipickle and motor bipickle. We were lucky to have shared many family trips. One of the most memorable, traveling by car to California. In Reno, Chris was maybe 6 or 7, and at a storefront casino, dad gave him a quarter and he pulled the handle, and I'll be darned if the kid didn't hit the jackpot. The casino staff is screaming at us to get out of there because it's completely illegal for kids to be gambling. But Chris was really tickled with his big cup of quarters that he won. I think it was about 25 bucks. Not bad for a little guy. Chris had a bright and curious mind. He could tell you the make and model of every car on the road, and he especially loved classic cars. He loved building things and fixing things. When he started in the school environment, it started becoming clear that there was some kind of a learning difficulty connecting letters and sounds. My parents fought for Chris to get the services that he needed, but he was failed miserably by our public school system. This set off years of Chris feeling absolutely terrible about himself. Self-esteem issues, and his way of dealing with it would be to distract and act like everything was fine. I think about my brother and my parents every time I meet a new student as a special education teacher. What he had should not have been a big deal, and it would have required minimal services, but the school refused to provide those for Chris. I'm a real wild one. He and I especially loved when we moved to our house on Triple Crown. There were woods to explore, friends, places to ride your bike. Part of the street wasn't finished at first. We called it the New Roads, and it was dirt. And Chris always had mini bikes, and he could go back there and just ramp and ride and just be a free-range kid. One summer I was watching him and our cousin Billy, and in 1 week, they both hit a bump and came down on their bikes and gashed their shins open. And it was the most disgusting thing I've ever seen. And they do it within a few days of each other, both ending up at the hospital. As Chris grew older, I always envied his individuality and creativity. He was an artist in many ways. He constantly was changing his style, dyeing his hair, adding artwork to his arms and body. He had a presence and a unique physical appearance. We were very opposite in that way. In high school, I was very buttoned up, wearing power suits, and he was punk rock meets James Dean. Chris was just 15 when he became an uncle when I had my son Ryan. He was really excited to be Ryan's uncle, even if he wasn't quite sure what to do, being just a 15-year-old kid himself with no experience with babies at all. But he was really proud of Ryan. One time, Mom had left Ryan at the house with Chris for just a few minutes while she ran up to the store. And Ryan is a little toddler where they're pointing at stuff, and he spotted a huge jar of maraschino cherries. And by the time Mom had got back from the store, Chris had fed Ryan almost the whole darn jar of cherries, just trying to make his little nephew happy. I had really hoped that Ryan and Chris would have the same birthday, but it ended up that they were one day apart, Chris being on April 16th and Ryan on the 17th. So there were many years that we celebrated their birthdays together, and that was kind of a special thing. When Chris was about 12, he got interested in cycling. And I got this message from his friend, Ray Ellington. If you look at the photo with Chris, Kevin, Chris Reinstatler, and I in our cycling clothes, you'll see three riders who were well aware that the young chubby kid they once knew was growing into a beast of a cyclist with lungs and legs that would make him a national champion. We could no longer keep up with this machine on our rides, and neither could most in his age group or country. It was a hard pill to swallow at first, but we quickly became proud just to be seen on training rides with this guy. I don't think many people knew this about Chris. He was a dedicated and gifted athlete and did exactly what his coaches asked him to do. They knew they had a star on their hands. I recently ran across one of Chris's original coaches when we were on our amateur team, the Queen City Wheels, and he still remembered the talented Chris 30 years later. Chris had many friends in his life, some of which have lasted a lifetime. His friend Barb Renninger said, "I first met Chris when I was 14 or 15 and he was crawling around in some weeds looking for his keys. I remember that because once you met Chris, you definitely did not forget meeting him. Also, he was very handsome and you know, 15-year-old girls hate that. He was many things, but I'll remember the goofiness, impulsivity, and unexpected, almost little boy sweetness. Also his laugh. The way he looked and how it sounded, like he was caught off guard by how funny something was, even if he was the one that had made the joke." Chris's friend Kathy Mason shared this memory of Chris. "Chris was a protector. I distinctly remember on the 97X riverboat cruise. He on high alert with this wretched dude messing with me. I will never forget him stepping up, asking if there was a problem, and calmly informing him to step away from the lady or he would end up in the river." I received this message from Timmy Carr. "My heart is completely broken. I remember being a kid and meeting Chris through my brothers and thinking he was the bee's knees, the coolest guy. And I've never changed my way of thinking about him, nor will I ever. I know the struggle and the weight that his heart carried, even though he never showed it. I don't think he wanted to put his burdens on anyone else, even though there were people that wanted him to. My family adored him, not just my brothers, but my parents also."
Some roads that you take, some bonds we'll choose to break. But I swore I'd never be the pallbearer. But I carry you to bed so you could rest your head. You were taking off a load of heavy drinking. The world it carries on in memories and songs. And your pictures on my wall are not forgotten. There were hymns that came from mouths that turned crosses upside down. And they came through their teeth with great ease. And all are bobbing heads and singing. And all have got a lot on their minds to think about, but you'll carry on in pictures and in songs, in the unmade bed you slept in, where I laid you down to rest one last time. Goodbye, dear friend. Goodbye. Some stories break your heart, some come with such applause, and it's buried deep inside where it's okay to cry. But some boys won't shed a tear, but I tell it like this here, You know it brings me down to places where it hurts the most. And all are bobbing heads and saying, and all have got a lot on their minds to think about, but you carry on in pictures and in song. In the unmade bed you slept in, where I laid you down to rest one last time. Goodbye, dear friend. Goodbye, dear friend. And you'll carry on through pictures and in songs. In the unmade bed you slept in, where I laid you down to rest one last time. Goodbye, dear friend. Goodbye.
I dreamed you, I saw your face, cut my lifeline when drifting through space. I saw an angel, I saw my fate. I can only thank God it was not too late. Over mountains I floated away, across an ocean.
Chris was so proud of his son Wyatt. Wyatt came along and re-energized our family. We all would go to Mom's on the days he'd be overexcited to see what new thing he was learning. There are 22 years between my son Ryan and little Wyatt. He's brought so much happiness to our family. He shares his dad's love of nature, and he is kind and extremely smart. Wyatt, of course, was upset to learn his dad had died, but he understands the final act of kindness by Chris. Chris had donated his organs, and as a result, he saved the lives of 4 people. One comment made over and over by people this past week was what a big heart he had. Now that heart has actually saved someone's life.
Everywhere I go, yeah, I found an angel. I found my place. I can only thank God it was not too late. I can only thank God it was not too late. I can only thank God it was not too late.
Thank you.
Birthday, Mom and Dad packed us into a VW van and we drove down to Florida. When you got out and saw the ocean for the first time, you took off running. And Dad started chasing after you, and then Mom and I just chased you and chased you. And you were just so happy. Just running and running, so excited. And that's how I see you now in my mind. Just free and happy. And that's how I'm gonna hold you in my heart.